Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning. You can go ahead and take a seat. Thanks for being friendly and greeting one another. We are reversing the typical order of the service this morning. And I don't know if that's fun for you or not. It's fun for me because here's what will happen. There are folks who will come in late, and don't look at them, right, because that makes everybody nervous. They'll come in late, and they'll see me preaching up here, and they'll look at their watch, and they'll look at their phone, and they'll go, I knew I was late. I didn't know I was that late. Oh, my goodness, what's happened? So make them feel comfortable when they come in late. But we're reversing it because we're gonna build into the celebration of baptism, and you'll have the opportunity to see several people get baptized this morning, and it really is powerful when someone has put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and you'll see them live out kind of a picture of their testimony this morning, and that's very, very powerful. It's powerful to me as your pastor, and I know many of you have been baptized. Some of you have not been, even though you are a follower of Jesus. Many of you were baptized here at First Baptist Church, and that's really cool. Many of you I had the privilege to baptize myself, and that's very meaningful to me. Others of you have been baptized, but you were not baptized here at First B, and that is absolutely okay. You'll probably still get to heaven, so that's all right. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. That's wonderful. But baptism is powerful. Sometimes it's funny, though. You've seen stories and heard stories. I saw a couple of pictures that made me laugh with baptism. Show some of those pictures for you. That's one. It looks like doesn't that look like the Knights Templars are baptizing there? I don't know where it's from, the Middle Ages, and he doesn't look happy about being baptized. Show the other ones there. That one, just that look, wide-eyed. And then, now, of course, you have to learn to baptize somewhere. So for those of us who baptize, show the picture of where you begin to learn to baptize. Clergy, preschool. You got to learn, right? You have to start somewhere. And then my favorite of all, show the next one. This is called drive-by baptism. We love that. Drive-by shootings, not so much. Drive-by baptism, we like that. So sometimes it's funny. We do something very unique here, and the folks who are baptized, in just a little while, you're going to hear some testimony from them. We videotape their testimony so they can share a little bit of their story, how they came to faith in Jesus Christ and why they want to be baptized. And you'll be inspired by those stories because the stories are just as unique as every individual who will tell them, as God created us all very unique. So you get to see those, and that's great. Sometimes what you don't get to see are kind of the funny moments that happen in the midst of it that don't make it into the finished video. And I want to show you one of those right now. We kind of call this baptism outtake. Check it out.
All right, so one of the ways that we start everybody's video is we say, my name is, and this is my story. So look at me and say that for me.
My name is, and this is my story.
Don't fill in the blank.
The best part of that, like it takes him a second, but then he gets it. Right at first, he doesn't get it. He's like, "What's the problem, Dad?" And then he gets it, and he breaks out laughing. So it's a lot of fun. You say people always say, "Well, why do we baptize and all this?" And we baptize. The real reason is because Jesus instructs us to do that. It's part of the mission that Jesus gave to us as His followers, that He gave to us as His church. And in Scripture, the place maybe we talk about it the most and see it the most is something called the Great Commission, Matthew chapter 28. If you've been in church, you'd be somewhat familiar with this, at least hearing this scripture, where Jesus, talking to those who follow Him, says, go and make disciples of all people. So go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So we're excited about doing that because Jesus instructs us to do that, and that's an important part of what we do. So baptism then becomes a picture of you and I expressing our faith in Jesus Christ. So we do it because Jesus commands it, and then it's expressing our faith and our commitment to Him. So that's the big picture of it, but then there are several smaller pictures involved in baptism that sort of all build into this one one big picture. So the word baptism is a Greek word, and what we've done with it is we've transliterated it. So we've taken the Greek letters that spell out a Greek word called baptizo, and we sort of turn those around and make it into an English word. So we find the closest English letter that fits with those Greek letters, and we put that into the language, and we call it baptism. So it's the Greek word baptizo. It's an interesting kind of word because it simply means to submerge or to immerse or to dunk or something like that. So that's part of the reason that we put people underwater is because that's simply the meaning of that, is to emerge or submerge someone. So if you're walking around in Jesus' day and you heard someone talk about baptism, it wouldn't involve a church service. If you're walking around in Jesus' day and people were talking about baptism, if you were in a marketplace, it might be women talking about dyeing cloth. So they'd have cloth of, maybe the cloth was white and they wanted it to be red, and so they would baptize that cloth and they would hold it under the water until the white cloth turned red. Now, we don't hold anyone underwater long enough for you to turn colors, okay? So we're not going to do that, except for perhaps the color blue. We might do that if it takes that long, but no, we don't do that. So for the longest time, you would have heard the word baptizo. It would have been just to immerse or submerge something, so it would have been very common. Battleships that sank, you know, if some people were fighting out on the Sea of Galilee and a ship sank, the ship would be baptized, and women would baptize their dishes when they washed them, and kids playing together would baptize one another when they dunked each other underwater. So it didn't have any religious significance. So for instance, in our summer event, and by show of hands, how many of you were in our summer event we call the backyard? Did you come? Somebody came to the backyard? It's our big carnival event that we have every July. So some of you, when we had a dunking booth, and some of you who joyfully dunked with great cheer and joy, your prominent and dignified pastor in the coldest water I've ever been in, those of you who did that, that would be said that you baptized me in that water. So thank you very much for that. So it would have been a very common thing. Baptism would have just been immersing something, submerging something, cloth, other people, whatever. Well, you begin to add something else to it. Check out this verse. Here's kind of a strange thing coming into the tradition. Luke chapter 11, story about Jesus. When Jesus had finished speaking, a Pharisee, so a Jewish religious leader in a group called the Pharisees, a Pharisee invited Jesus to eat with him. So, hey, Jesus, why don't you come over? We'll have some lunch together. So Jesus went in and reclined at the table with the Pharisee. But the Pharisee, noticing that Jesus did not first wash before the meal, was surprised. So Jesus comes in to eat, sits down at the table, and the Pharisee says to him, hey, did you forget something? You know, we don't have any hand sanitizer, but you could have washed your hands before you came. Kind of like you do with your children, right? Did you forget something? You're supposed to wash up before you come to dinner. So he noticed that. The word is ebaptiste, which is a same theme of that same word, baptizo. And it says he did not wash, noticing that Jesus did not wash. Now, it was probably meant a little more than washing his hand. Probably would have been kind of a combination of saying grace and washing in a very ritualistic way. But that's the word. And he noticed that Jesus did not first baptize. That Jesus didn't baptize. That he didn't wash. So baptism really is a picture of being washed. And we can see that picture, and you will see that this morning. Water, not only throughout the Old Testament, but really through most religious traditions, is a symbol of purification. All throughout the ancient world, for sure, certainly back into the Old Testament, going all the way back to the time of Moses, God would command people to wash their clothes as a symbolic act of purification. He'd command people to wash themselves as an act, a ritualistic act of purification. And so Jewish people would be instructed to wash themselves if they came in contact with something unclean, if they came in contact with a dead body. So some of this is just sort of sanitary good sense, correct? If you came in contact with a dead body, you might wash yourself. Or if you were a Gentile, meaning a non-Jewish person, and you decided that you wanted to convert to Judaism, the faith of the people in the Old Testament, you would have to wash yourself in a ritualistic baptism. Now, if you were a guy, if you were a male and you were going to convert from Gentile to Judaism, baptism was the easy part. Circumcision would have been the difficult part. So you would have loved your baptism day, not so much your circumcision day. But there's a long Jewish tradition of this washing as purification. And then into that tradition came a rather strange guy. Mark chapter 1, verse 4. John, came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance, of turning away, and for the forgiveness of sins. So this was a little different from the tradition, because the tradition that in Judaism was washing, but you would wash yourself. You'd wash your own clothes, you would wash yourself. Now here comes this man, John, and he's washing other people. And so they called him, John the Washer, John the Dipper, John the Submerger, John the Immerser, John the Dunker. If they didn't like him, they probably called him John the Drowner. And if you've been in church and you've heard this story, we call him John the Baptist. John the Baptist. Now, I thought growing up that that simply meant he went to a Baptist church. So I knew he didn't go to our Baptist church, because I didn't see a guy that looked crazy like that in our church, but I thought he must have gone to a Baptist church. So John the Baptist, kind of like, you know, Paul the Presbyterian, or Millie the Methodist, or Larry the Lutheran, or Agnes the Apostolic, or Bart the Brethren, or Norm the non-denominational, Joshua the Jehovah's Witness. I don't know. I could go on if I kept thinking about him, I guess. But he was really John the Washer. And then he did that, and then he told people that there was a Messiah coming. So you need to repent. You need to turn from your evil ways. And then you need to let me wash you as a symbol of cleansing and forgiveness. And a lot of people responded, and John washed a lot of people. And then he shared with them his main message. Again, Mark chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. John was preaching. So here's his message. Someone more powerful than I will come after me, and I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. In John's gospel, again, John the Baptist sees Jesus walking toward him, and in this great picture, he says, look, there is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. I came baptizing with water so that he might be revealed to you. So John says, I can wash you with water, and you can repent, and I can symbolize that forgiveness. But here's Jesus, the Lamb of God. He will take away your sins. And Jesus actually did that at the cross. And there it was also a picture of washing, only it was not a washing with water. It was a washing with his blood. 1 John 1, verse 7, the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Now, so baptism is this outward washing that is symbolic of an inward washing. This outward washing that's symbolic of an inward washing. So you get washed with the water on the outside because the blood of Jesus has washed you clean on the inside. So we know you can wash on the outside and not get washed on the inside. Obviously, people can do that, but that won't make you clean. Only being washed on the inside by the blood of Jesus makes you clean. But then once that's happened, then you have this symbolic washing from the outside. You trust Jesus to make you clean from the inside out. And as we go through the New Testament, we see a lot of people participating in that. When people come to follow Jesus and realize that his blood was shed for their sins, that washing on the inside takes place, and then they participate in that washing on the outside. Acts chapter 16 has got a great example of that. It's a great story. Paul and Silas are in prison, and there's an earthquake, and the prison doors open up, and the guards are scared to death that, you know, if the prisoners get away, the Roman authorities are going to kill the guards because it's their fault. And they turn to Paul and Silas and say, hey, what must we do to be saved? What must we do to have eternal life? And Paul and Silas said to them, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and that washing on the inside by the blood of Jesus will take place. And then notice, right after that, right away, he and all of his family were baptized. So you trust Jesus to clean the inside, and then there's no reason for you to wait for anything else to participate in the washing of the outside. Show that next picture. I didn't show this, or didn't talk about this in the first day. Now, there's some people who are really committed to Jesus, right? Chip away the ice. They're not going to wait till spring to get baptized. They're going to jump in the middle of the ice. I hope none of them died. So, but anyway, they would go see Jesus. But I had a guy, the first person I baptized, he'd come to faith in Christ. His name was Danny Self. He's a great guy. He'd come to faith in Christ, and then it was like he kept putting off being baptized. And I'd say, well, we're having a baptism this day. And he didn't want to be baptized, and he kept putting it off. And I later found out the reason he was putting it off, he was trying to break himself of some habits that he had. You know, he considered them bad habits, and he was trying to break himself of those habits before he was baptized. And we finally got down to having that conversation. You know what? It kind of seems silly now when you think about it. The habit that he had that he was trying to break before he got baptized was smoking cigarettes. I said, Danny, that's no big deal. I said, you just need to fire one up before we go into the baptism, and we'll take you in there with the cigarette. We'll put it out in the water. How does that sound? I was secretly hoping he would do that. He wouldn't really follow through with that. The other story, and I've told you this before, the cleansing happens on the inside, and it happens from God's perspective all at once. You are a new creature. Sometimes it takes a while for it to get to every area of your life. One of my favorite baptisms was a guy who'd lived a very, very hard life. His name was Danny Butler, and he came to be baptized, and we baptized him, and everybody applauded and celebrated like you'll do this morning. And then he walked up the stairs to a little landing and then down the stairs to the dressing room, and the stairs were wet. And he slipped on the stairs. It was a small, about half the size of this auditorium. He slipped on the stairs and let out a stream of curse words on the way down. And it was one of those moments, right? Everything got quiet for a split second because people said, you know, this is really funny and we want to laugh, but this is church and we don't know if we should laugh. So it took a split second, kind of like Carter in his video. It took a second to get it, and then everybody burst out laughing. So, but Jesus had cleansed him on the inside. It had just taken a while, hadn't quite got all the way to his mouth yet when something like that happens. But baptism is the start, a watercolor picture of being washed on the inside. It's a watercolor picture of that when we see you get washed on the outside. Here's the second thing. It's also a picture of being dead, buried, and resurrected. Dead, buried, and resurrected. You know what? I like a picture of me being all wet doesn't really bother me. In fact, in the middle of the summer, I probably kind of like that. A picture of me being dead and buried, I'm not so comfortable with that. I don't like that. You've seen this happen. You go to a funeral, someone's in the casket, somebody inevitably will say, "She looks good, doesn't she?" And I go, "Does she? Does she? She's dead. She doesn't look good. We'd much rather see her alive than in the casket. Isn't that true? She doesn't look good. She'd look better if she were alive." In the greatest reversal of all, baptism is the picture of both those things. It's a picture of all those things. It is a picture of being dead. It's a picture of being buried. It's a picture of being raised to new life. It's a picture of Jesus being dead and buried and raised to life on the third day. It's a picture of you being dead to your sins, being buried with Christ, being raised to new life in Jesus Christ. Let's read this out loud together. This is God's words, Romans chapter 6. It's a little small. I think maybe you can read that. It's really clear. So read this out loud with me as we share this testimony. Here we go. Or are you unaware that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him by baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in a new way of life. For if we have been joined with him in the likeness of his death, we will certainly also be in the likeness of his resurrection. You see the picture? Jesus died for you. You were baptized into his death. Jesus was buried. You were buried with him through baptism. Jesus was raised from death by the glory of the Father. You were raised in the same way to walk in newness of life. That's why we call it watercolor pictures. Last two things. Baptism is the picture of your public identification with Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Baptism is the oldest school way of worshiping out there. Early Christians, when they came to follow Jesus, when they came to believe he was the Son of God and his death paid the price for their sins, they were baptized publicly. That's why, and sometimes people ask this, that's why we only have baptisms in public worship celebration. We don't have private baptisms because baptism by its nature was a public testimony, a public declaration of who Jesus was and what he had done in your life. So when you're baptized, it is your public identification with Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. I think of it like this. I think it was actually Jason Poland who first gave me this example in our membership class. But this morning, as always, I'm wearing my wedding ring. And I put my wedding ring on the day that Rebecca and I got married only 24 years ago. Only 24 years ago. We were 15. It was so romantic. It was so romantic. Unfortunately, we were like twice that age. But anyway, so next year will be our 25th wedding anniversary. That's pretty cool, our 25th anniversary. And 25 years of wedded bliss. I have a special surprise for Rebecca. Don't tell her because she doesn't know this yet. I'm going to take her to a very romantic place for our 25th wedding anniversary. I'm thinking maybe Paris. Pretty good, huh? But France, not Kentucky. There is a Paris, Kentucky, but Paris, France. I'm thinking, so for our 25th anniversary, I'm going to take her to to Paris. And I already have planned for our 50th wedding anniversary. I think I'm going to go back and get her at that point. So that's going to be really, I'm just that romantic if you know me. So by the way, you know, I wear my wedding ring. If you see me not wearing my wedding ring, that'll probably be the last time that you ever see me. Right? Because Rebecca will send me to go on to be with Jesus. So I guess that's all right. But I didn't have to put on the ring to be married, did I? Lots of people get married without a wedding ring. Nothing wrong with that. So I don't have to put on a ring to be married. And if for some reason I'm not wearing the ring, I'd still be married, correct? I mean, I'd be deceased, but I'd still be married. I think it would still count. But I wear the ring to be reminded that I'm married. So it reminds anyone who sees. So if someone sees me wearing the ring, they'll know that I'm married. So when I'm out in the community and people see me, they know I'm married. When the swimsuit models see me and they're interested in me, they see my ring, and that's not funny. What's wrong with you? They see the ring and they know that I'm married. And then, of course, when I see the swimsuit models, I see the ring, and it reminds me that I'm married to a beautiful woman named Rebecca that I love very, very much. So it's a way that I publicly identify with being married and, of course, with the one that I'm married to. Baptism is the picture of you publicly being identified with Jesus and his death, his burial, his resurrection. When you see someone baptized this morning, let it remind you of Jesus and the gospel. Let it remind you that he died for their sins. Let it remind you that he died for your sins. And that not only they can be made new, you can be made new. Here's the last thing. Baptism is a picture of your personal transformation through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. We read those words together. We were buried with him by baptism into death. We're buried with him by baptism into death. It is a picture of that. Intentionally, you walk into the water and someone else grabs a hold of you, and right before you go down, you'll close your eyes and you'll hold your breath, and somebody's going to put you underwater, and you can't breathe underwater. And if you got buried underwater, you'd die if you were there. But no sooner than we put you underwater like that, we bring you up out of the water. Death and burial, symbolizing death and burial and resurrection. Just as Jesus was raised to the glory of the Father, so you and I are raised to walk in new life. So it's a picture of what Jesus has done for you. And then don't miss this one. It is a picture of what Jesus does to you. Of what Jesus does to you. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So it's symbolic of the old you being dead and buried. And as a result of believing in Jesus, you are raised to life as a brand new person. And by the way, that's one of the reasons, again, that we baptize by immersion. We put you all the way under the water, symbolizing that all of you has been dead and buried with Christ, and all of you is rising to walk in a brand new life. And it's the real picture of what God has done in your life. I'll give you this example, and then we'll close. Suppose you come up to my wife, Rebecca, and you say to her, "Hey, Rebecca, have you got a picture of your husband? Have you got a picture of your husband with you?" And so Rebecca looks in her pocketbook and she pulls out this picture. And she goes, "Hey, here's a picture of my husband." And you're going to go, "Wow, that preacher really photographs quite well. He doesn't look nearly that good in person, for goodness sakes." And so you say to Rebecca, you say, "Look, I don't know how to say this to you, but I don't really think that's your husband. I don't really think that's your husband." And Rebecca looks at the picture and she looks at you and she says, "Hey, you're right, that's not really my husband. But a girl can dream, can't she? For goodness sakes, why is it such a big deal?" And she says, "After all, the picture doesn't really matter, does it? I mean, I know that's not really my husband, but I'm telling you, this is a picture of him, but the picture doesn't really mean anything. It doesn't really matter." But you go, "Well, it kind of does, because if she shows you a picture of anybody except me, she's not showing you a real picture of her husband. She's not showing you a real picture of, and maybe I would wish it wasn't, but she, you know, maybe I wish I looked more like that. But if she doesn't show you a picture of me, she's not showing you a real picture of me." You see, baptism is the real picture. It's the real picture of you. If you've surrendered your life, committed your life to Jesus Christ, it is the real picture of you. It doesn't need to be photoshopped, because it's beautiful. It's perfect just like it is. Because this picture is a picture of you. This is you. Baptism is you buried with Christ in baptism. This is you. all your sins washed away. This is you rising to walk with Jesus in a new life for the rest of your life and for all of eternity. This is you made new in Christ Jesus. And don't miss it. Baptism is a picture. This is a picture of you made new in Christ Jesus. You're going to see those pictures. You're going to see those living watercolor pictures this morning as we worship. I'm going to invite you to stand with me, and we're going to pray, and then the ushers are going to come take the offering after that, and as they are taking the offering, you're going to see the videos from the folks who were baptized in the first service. You're going to see those living watercolor pictures of people made new. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. Thank you for all that you are and all that you do. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to see a picture of what you have done in the lives of so many and what you are going to do in some of our lives, even this very day, that we're going to be made new in Jesus Christ, washed from the inside out by the shed blood of Jesus, symbolized by the washing in water and baptism. Lord, may that bear powerful witness to all of us as we worship. And Lord, may we worship this morning, not just in receiving from you, but as now we have the opportunity to worship in giving to you. As we bring our tithes and our offerings and our gifts back to you, may you receive them and bless them, multiply them, use them to further your kingdom, to build your church, to glorify the name of Jesus Christ, that many far and near, some in this very room, would be made new in Jesus Christ our Lord. For it's in his name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
My name is Jed, and this is my story. So it was at this church, and we were celebrating communion, and I accepted Jesus into my heart, and I started learning more about him, and that's when I loved him, and he came in my heart. That when I do something hard, I know that he's with me and I can just push through it instead of just going, I'm done. And when I was little, when I got hurt, I was like, ah! And then now that I have Jesus in my heart, I feel like, oh, he's with me. I want to be baptized because I want to spread the gospel with other people, and I also want to show other people that I believe in him.
My name is Claire, and this is my story. We were driving back from Indiana in our van, and I was just wondering, like, Micah was already a Christian, and I was, like, wondering, like, how did he do it, like, was it something he said, or like how? And then I asked him, and he says, well, I said a special prayer, and then all he came into my heart. And so I said that prayer, and then I remember yelling, Mom, I'm a Christian. Then she threw to the front of the car, and they were like, oh, that's great, honey. And it was fun. Some people that have helped me know Christ are my Awana leaders and my parents. They're and helping me learn verses at like church and at home. With Christ in my life is different because like I feel like he calms me down when I get mad at like my siblings or my parents or just life in general. And so like I feel like he calms me down and like helps me like regroup. Be baptized because I want to show the church and everyone that I want to be part of God's family, and I'm not gonna like stray away, do something he doesn't want me to do. Of course we all sin, but I'm gonna try to keep on track like one of those monorails.
compose myself for a minute. All right. I'd like to just invite you to stand as we continue this morning. And it's such a great first service, and it was so powerful to see my kids make that step. And I'm so excited about what we're going to see here in a minute. But as we wait for that moment, let's take some time to just really sing about our Lord, sing about the one who makes this moment possible, who makes it mean anything, and who is the one who saves us from our sins and calls us to be his children. And so let's join together as we sing. Sing with me.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sing what the angels will sing, and we'll sing it with them.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 yeah, this is amazing grace. This is a for all that you've done for me.
you can clap. Clap to Jesus. Exactly. This next song, I love this song for Baptism Sunday because it talks about our identity. And I was saved at a very young age, and I was baptized when I was a teenager. But it took me a long time to really bring it into my heart that the love of God is really unconditional. There's no precondition except that you're lost. And when you are found, when you accept him, there's no condition that I love you if, or I'll love you when. It's I love you. And so as these folks today come forward, regardless of their age, and they follow Christ's words and his and what he wants us to do and be baptized and are obedient to him in that way, it gives him great pleasure, but his salvation is already done, right? It's already taken care of. And our identity as children is locked up by him, not by anything that we do. And so I just want you to think about when we're watching these folks be obedient and follow what their Savior wants them to do, like he's delighted in them. They're his children. We're all brothers and sisters in Christ. Our identity is sure. And that's what I love about this song, Who You Say I Am. And I'll capo up. I did that the first service too. It's an emotional Sunday.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free is free. Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place. Say I am.
My name is Jed, and this is my story. So it was at this church, and we were celebrating communion, and I accepted Jesus into my heart, and I started learning more about him, and that's when I loved him, and he came in my heart. That when I do something hard, I know that he's with me and I can just push through it. And so just going, I'm done. And when I was little, when I got hurt, I was like, ah! And then now that I have Jesus in my heart, I feel like, oh, he's with me. I want to be baptized because I want to spread the gospel with other people, and I also want to show other people that I believe in him.
Good morning. It's a great joy for me to be here today at First Baptist Church. I've been here before with my wife, but this is an extra special day today. I'm Aaron Wahlberg's dad. And many years ago, I had the privilege of baptizing Aaron when she was about Jed's age. And now I have the great honor to be baptizing Jed today. My grandson and I have been in the water a lot together through the years at lakes and ponds. We've had a lot of fun, but I gotta say, there's no more special day than today to be in the water with Jed and to watch him declare his faith publicly that he wants to follow Jesus all the days of his life. All right, Jed, I know you've committed your life to Jesus Christ, haven't you?
Yes.
And you want to live for Jesus and follow and serve him for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Until we get to heaven someday as part of his forever family, isn't that right? I'm so proud of you, Jed. You know, his name, Jedidiah, comes from the Bible, and it means loved by the Lord. Boy, there is no other way that is more special in which the Lord has loved Jed than sending Jesus to die for him. And Jed has acknowledged that. He's accepted Jesus as his personal Savior. And so it's my privilege today to baptize Jed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
My name is Claire, and this is my story. Driving back from Indiana in our van, and I was just wondering, like, Micah was already a Christian, and I was like wondering, like, how did he do it? Like, was it something he said, or like how? And then I asked him, and he says, well, I said a special prayer, and then all he came into my heart, and so I said that prayer. Yelling, Mom, I'm a Christian, and to the front of the car, and they're like, oh, that's great, honey, and it was fun. Some people that have helped me know Christ are my Awana leaders and my parents. They've been good at giving me advice and helping me learn verses at, like, church and at home. With Christ in my life is different because, like, I feel like he calms me down when I get mad at, like, my siblings or my parents or just life in general. And so, like, I feel like he calms me down and, like, helps me, like, regroup. And, like, yeah, something like that. I want to be baptized because I want to show the church and everyone that I want to be part of God's family, and I'm not going to, like, stray away, do something he doesn't want me to do. Of course, we all sin, but I'm gonna try to keep on track, like one of those monorails.
Well, I'm privileged to have 5 grandchildren, my wife and I, but one of them, only one of them, is a girl. So Claire is my special princess, and even what makes me more happy than being her grandpa is knowing that she has a Heavenly Father, and that she loves Jesus, and she's committed her life to Jesus. I'm so proud of you, Claire. And today we stand before these friends and church family members because I know you're ready to say that you don't want your faith to be a secret, that you're not afraid to be known as a Christian, and that you're going to follow Jesus for all of your life. Have you committed your life to Jesus Christ?
Yes.
We just heard the story of how that happened. We're so proud of you, Claire. And I'm so excited as your grandpa to be able to have this honor today to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hi, my name is Lisa, and this is my story. I grew up in a Christian family. We didn't really go to church too much, just mainly Mass, Christmas time. But I do remember in high school my mom encouraging me to read my Bible. It wasn't until I got engaged to Jim that we started going to church together and learning more about Jesus and coming and growing into our faith then. So because we had to, it was Bloomingdale Church that we got married in. And so we had to do the premarital counseling classes, the sessions with that pastor, and we got to know the pastor more. He encouraged us to meet with other family, young families in the church, and so we started going to their small group, and that just opened up my heart to God. And I think so there wasn't really a defining moment where I came to Jesus, but it was just a period of growing and opening the Bible more and reading His Word. We got married there in Bloomingdale Church, and then we started having kids. And I think as a parent, my faith has grown too, because I want to teach them more about God, and one day I want them to accept Jesus in their hearts. So I can't do that if I'm not doing it. So I think being a parent has helped me too grow in my faith. And then it just kind of led all up to this point of publicly showing everyone that Christ is my Savior and I want to live my life for God.
Lisa, have you asked Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, committed yourself to follow Him for the rest of your life?
Yes.
In accordance with Jesus' command to all of us to be baptized, your profession of faith in Him, I baptize you this morning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hello, my name is Jim, and just what Lisa said. Hello, my name is Jim, and this is my story. I was raised going to a Catholic church with my mom and my grandfather, and we went through baptisms and confirmations and reconciliations, but when I was younger, there wasn't an internal value in that, and I didn't know what any of it meant. So I continued to live my life through grade school, elementary, middle school, high school, college, and just kind of drifted away from anything that I learned in that time. And over time, I became kind of selfish, and growing up, as I drifted away, my faith was in my family, my mom, my dad, my grandparents, my friends, my sisters. I don't know if it was a specific turning point, it was a turning period, I'll call it. But it was about July 19th, 2008, when I faithfully believe that the Lord brought Lisa and me together in Chicago. And we were engaged less than a year after starting to date. And from that day moving forward, we knew we wanted to get married in a church. And upon a few Google searches, we found a church in Bloomingdale and decided we were going to move forward, engaged and together and married and start our family. And do that in front of the Lord. Fast forward a few more years, we come to First Baptist Church, and we're a little more mature in our faith. We've trusted in the Lord. We've had a few children, which every single time we were in the hospital with a child, that was probably the most impact on my heart and my head is knowing that His creation is happening, and it is a gift from God to Lisa and I and the rest of the world having the three children. Our first few months here, getting the tap on the shoulder from Matt Wahlberg to join a small group. That group has been an extreme blessing for us. Building the relationship with you, Pastor Greg, and Pastor Joshua, and Jason, and Aaron. Those are relationships I value extremely. When we, Lisa and I committed ourselves to each other in front of the Lord in Bloomingdale Church, I feel like that was just a small percentage of who I am today and what I was able to become as far as a faithful servant of the Lord, where maybe that's 75% of where I am now, and to fully get over that hump, let's get baptized. Let's clean ourselves of all of our sins and be 100% in with God. My salvation is in my relationship with Christ and being a believer.
Jim, do you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you've committed yourself to follow Him the rest of your life?
I certainly do.
Then in accordance with Jesus' command to all of us to be baptized, in your profession of faith in Him this day, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
My name is Selena, and this is my story. I accepted Jesus in my heart when I saw my mom and dad praying, and then I wanted to start praying on my own. Since I accepted Jesus in my heart, my life is different, but I feel safer and more confident. And now I pray for my friends and family when they're sad and going through a bad time. I want to be baptized today because when I read the Bible every now and then, I see that it talks about getting baptized, and He wants you to get baptized. Also, because my family, most of them, got baptized, and I want to follow that.
So, Selena, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior and committed yourself to follow Him for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Then, in accordance with Jesus' command to all of us to be baptized, and your profession of faith in Jesus, then I baptize you this morning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yes, I ask Jesus into my heart to forgive me. I sometimes go in my room and pray to Jesus because I'm upset sometimes. When I pray to Him, I feel better. Because I want to show people I want to follow Jesus.
Hey, I'm Jason Pohl, I'm the executive pastor. I love my job, but this is way more fun than budgets and dealing with broken air conditioners. So, right, Liv? Yeah, so about 6 years ago today, I got to be here with Olivia's older sister, Ashley. And so she had said that she wanted to get baptized, and so we get to share this again today. So, Olivia, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Are you here today because you want to let people know that you want to follow Jesus?
Yes.
All right. Well, based on your profession of faith, you sharing with people that you want to follow Jesus, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
My name is Isaac, and this is my story. I heard a friend ask Jesus into my his heart, so I asked my mom about it. We talked about Jesus dying on the cross for our sins. She said I could pray for Jesus to go in my heart and forgive my sins. I want to be baptized because I want everybody to know I ask Jesus into my heart.
All right. My name is Chris Keenan. I'm Isaac's dad. And so I was told I could have the opportunity to baptize him today. So I took that because I'm very excited and very proud to call him a brother in Christ. So, Isaac, have you accepted Jesus as your Savior and chosen to follow him for the rest of your life?
Yes.
And are you getting baptized because you want to show everybody that you're part of the family of God?
Yes.
Okay. Then, in accordance with Jesus' command and by the profession of your faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
My name is Carter, and this is my story. We were watching a movie, and then we started talking about Jesus because I made a connection. And then my dad asked me if I wanted to accept Jesus into my heart, and I said I didn't think I was ready because I didn't know if my body could handle it yet. A week later, I was in the garage with my dad. And he asked if I thought more about it, and I said I wanted to do it. And then we went ahead and I accepted Jesus into my heart. I know Jesus is in my heart because, like, I feel different. Because I have the Holy Spirit in me, and it just, like, makes, like, when I'm getting mad, like, gonna, like, getting act up and I'm gonna yell at Cooper, my brother. I remember that I have the Holy Spirit and that God doesn't want me, like, when I'm gonna yell, I'm, like, remembering that I have the Holy Spirit and that I accepted Jesus in my heart, and then I don't yell. A couple months ago, I moved away from all my friends. I knew a school I loved, my house, my neighbors. I moved to Judson. It was just a scary time. And so when I left, I was so scared, so sad, but God helped me through it. I just knew God was with me and it helped me stay confident and be brave. I decided to get baptized because it's the next step for loving God and my path of faith, and because I just want everyone to know that I love Jesus.
He's on a stool. He didn't grow a foot in the last. I asked if they have one for me, but they don't, so. Well, nothing can really describe the moment that we get to share in today. I'm just so blessed to be able to be here with Carter, my oldest, and my brother in Christ, right? We're brothers now.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say as little as possible. Carter, have you accepted Jesus into your heart?
Yes.
And have you committed your life to him and living as he commands you?
Yes.
In accordance with Jesus' command to be baptized and based on your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Oh, that is so, so awesome. Boy, thank you guys so much for being here. Why don't you go ahead and stand up? And we're going to let all our kids go to exit back down to FBC Kids right now. So you guys can go ahead and do that. Oh, what a great, great time. A friend of mine serves in a church in Georgia. He told me this story. He said they had a little boy who on a Sunday morning just like this, I don't know if they were having baptisms or not, but he went down to children's church like he would normally do. And in the process of hearing the gospel over a long period of time, as we do in FBC Kids, and they do there, his son received Christ, prayed to receive Christ. And so his teacher was excited about this, and she told him, she said, well, when you're done, when children's church is over and church is over, you go back up there and you tell the pastor that you have prayed to receive Christ, you've been saved, and you want to be baptized. You've been saved and you want to be baptized. Well, some time passed, and he had some other conversations, but he did finally make it back up to the pastor, and service is over, and he goes up to the pastor, and he said, Pastor, I just want to tell you what happened to me. I've been saved, and I want to be advertised. But it is, isn't it? It's the proclamation. It's the advertising of what Jesus Christ has done, and in the lives of these individuals that you've seen, it's what he's done in their lives. My prayer is that it's what he's done in your life, and if not, I can promise you it is something that he wants to do, and he will do in your life. When those people, when you are in Christ, all things are new. Old things have passed away. All things become new. You become new in Jesus Christ. Whatever you do, do not miss that. You've seen the picture of it this morning. It's a picture of these folks. It can be a picture of you as well. A picture of you made new in Christ Jesus. Would you bow with me as we pray? Lord God, we love you. Thanks for the opportunity to worship you this morning. Thank you for the living watercolor pictures we have seen of people, adults and children whom you have made new in Jesus Christ. Lord, we see that picture and we celebrate. May that picture be taken. May that be the real picture of each and every one of us as we come to Christ, as we surrender to Christ, as we commit ourselves to follow Jesus Christ all the days of our life, that our lives too will be a picture of someone made new in a risen and living Savior, Jesus Christ. May that be said of us, and may we share that story with all those around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship together as we close this morning. If you need prayer, come on down. We'd love to pray with you this morning.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the Lord.
failed the promise. Your buried body began to break out of the silence. The roaring lion declared the has no claim on thee. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe out of the silence. The roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on thee. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. God, you are my living hope.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. All right, everybody, go and have a great day, and thank you for coming.